present a conversation with Dr. Emmanuel Ravizzi. Dr. Ravizzi has a long and distinguished career, which he began in his native Romania, where he was an assistant professor of medicine. He performed vital cancer research in Paris until the Second World War cut short his research in Paris. He then moved to Mexico City, where he founded the Institute for Applied Biology. He founded a second institute by the same name in New York City, where he currently continues his important research in cancer, AIDS, and other fields. He's graciously accepted to be here with us today to discuss some of the results of his 70-odd years of research. Our panel today is Mr. Adrian Himmelbrand and Mr. Sal DiBella. Mr. Himmelbrand will begin with the first question for Dr. Ravizzi.
Dr. Ravizzi, in your research, you have developed a new concept of dualism in biology and medicine. Would you care to expand on that concept?
I will try it. A dualism in general, in nature, appears more evident continuously. The existence of entropic forces with a tendency to destruction until the disappearance of any existing thing is opposed by the negentropic constructive, who not only opposed, unfortunately, we know, doesn't oppose us completely with the entropy progressing. We were impressed by this, and we thought also something similar in biology, in nature. It started long, long time ago when I had patient, a group of around, you know, it's only think hospital around 60 patients, terminal cases of cancer. And I was impressed by anything. They were almost all with pain. But some of them had the pain in the morning, and in the evening, more or less calm. Another group, it was exactly the opposite. The morning, they were calm, and the intense pain was in the evening and middle of the night. I was following by days and days to the same patient and the constant character of their pain. For weeks and more, this character didn't change. This idea of a dualism started, it was very much confirmed by something else. The patient with pain in the morning, by eating, had their pain decreased. And most of them were eating in the morning, one after the other, to compensate, to reduce their pain. Opposite, the people with the evening pain had the pain increased by eating. They were increased so much that they, most of them, especially in the evening, they don't touch the food. This dualism appeared for me not clear, and I started to study these cases and to find what relationship with something else is in the problem of pain in the morning and pain in the evening. And we started to find in the urine one has a characteristic to have an essay during. When the other, it was the opposite, an alkaline urine. We studied the urine more, and we found more the reaction in the urine. The amount of chloride eliminated, many other things. It was a reaction which I made measuring the surface tension, which high in one group and low in the other. The ideas of a dualism became now very clear, and we started really to study as much as possible the origin and mechanism of this pain. We had several cases with ulcerated lesion and with a fluid, and with all this had an alkaline pain. And really, we measured the pH in the place in the wound ulcerated in the fluid to find it strongly alkaline. We measure in other places in the body under the skin, we found that the classical 7-4, 7-5, and in the place of the ulceration we found that above 8, even 8.5. This brought us immediately in mind to see what happened in the patient with an acid pain. And I remember I had a patient with a tumor in the face, in which he told, in this specific place I have pain, not in the other. I asked him, and he asked me, to measure locally the pH. How? I make a very small incision, I introduce an electrode, a glass electrode, and in the moment when he was in pain, I found not 7.4 or 7.2, what is normal, and not 8 like in alkaline pain, we found 5.5, 5.8. I measured immediately under the skin of the man, and we found that the normal 7.6, 7.8. We had already now at other basis to what was related the production in the one place of an alkali and the other an acid. I knew from acid the of Warburg's research, who has shown that in some cases appear lactic acids. I had a patient with a very big tumor of the knee and efferent veins dilated. And he was in severe pain, an acid pain. I took the blood from here, especially in the moment when he was with a severe pain, and we measured the lactic acid to find much more than 4 or 5 times than a normal case. In the blood in general, we find that high. We had already lactic acid in the place of acid pain. We started to analyze the cases with alkaline. The thing was very simple because they were ulcerated and they fluid. We took some fluid, they were carbonates, sodium and potassium, but sodium carbonate in abnormal quantity. Acid lactic in one place, carbonate in the other. What produces lactic acid and what produces the other? I was in this time, for long, long time, working the problem of the lipids. I was so far, and I found it was now, there are still books in which speaking about lipids was only a half a page. I found a publication in 1841 in France, a little booklet approved by the censor, because it was in 1941. And in the title I have the role, a disequilibre oxybiotic, role of the lipids. I studied the lipids. And I found at the beginning not a satisfactory definition of the lipids. Even today, in the book, it tells a substance which is more soluble in neutral solvents than in water. Chemically, they had lipids. I could not find a chemical definition to satisfy me. I was working myself in general. I am an MD, but I'm very much interested in physics. And I have now a series of very important physics which will be published now in Germany. They hope to have a special interesting prize for this in physics. So I applied to the lipids a new definition, not utilizing chemical substances, but utilizing, which I found very important, the forces present. And this is a publication, the definition which I gave when I was in Europe in 40, in which I told a lipid, it is a non-polar group in which the non-polar group is predominant, until my definition gave it a little more detail, in which the van der Waals cohesion forces are bigger than the electrostatic forces of the polar group. I am very pleased to see today, in different publication, my definition, and more than this, in several colleges, the definition of the lipids for the student is the definition which I gave. I tried to see in the case of pain, are the lipids involved? And when I started to study the lipids, I defined them also with a polar group. It means with electrical charges. Could be either positive, like in hydroxyl, or hydroxyl or amine, or an acid, negative, like a carboxyl or even a carbonyl. I thought this dualism in lipids to be possible corresponding to the dualism in the pain. And I started to look for the lesion ulcerated, was very simple. Unfortunately, I had a patient with a very big lesion who died, and the autopsy which I made her, I took this material and studied, and I found something very, very interesting. A specific acid. An acid who has as characteristic three double bonds parallel, conjugated tri-N. I tried lipids in the other thing and I found exaggerated sterol, cholesterol. I make a little parenthesis. I described in my book in a lot of pages this abnormal fatty acid, the trienic conjugated fatty acid, by the name, by the formula, and by a lot of spectral analysis with characteristic peaks. 3 years ago, and somebody else, Mr. Peterson, published the existence of the same trienic conjugated fatty acid. These three double bonds parallel, and he received the Nobel Prize for this. Things which are in detail, in pages in my book. They asked me, as a parenthesis, I am not interested in this thing, but anyhow, I was pleased that I gave my idea published 20 years before, has been confirmed by somebody else. I found the trienic conjugated fatty acid as pathological lipids in the alkaline pain. And we studied what happened, how this works, and this is part of my much more advanced than Peterson, how they are working. I showed that they are bounding electively halogen, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. And it is even method to determine the amount of conjugated double bond, double bond in general, through the iodine fixation. I found, looking in this material, that this fatty acid had also chlorine 5-6. From where comes the chlorine? From the sodium chloride. What happened? We know the sodium chloride is dissociating. The chloride is taken by our abnormal fatty acid, and the sodium is bound with the carbonic anion, which is so abundant in the body, making the carbonate, which I found when I studied the fluid. And so we have now known exactly, we have the L-alkaline pain produced by the abnormal fatty acid, the trienic conjugated, who are binding the chloride of the sodium chloride, leaving the sodium to be bound by the carbonic anion and to make the alkaline carbonate. Further, all the things. It was a question a little different because the sterols have a completely different activity. And I found it was Warburg who showed that in the production of the lactic acid, the sterols determine an anoxybiosis. This means a biology without oxygen. How? And here it is. They produce an impermeabilization by working as a membrane of the cell, producing impermeabilization, and impermeabilization especially for the oxygen. And then we have, very interesting, the metabolism of the glucose leading to the, from the glycogen, who part of them is making an anoxybiotic metabolism with production of lactic acid. We have this, the entire biology of the pain, acid and alkaline dualistic produced by acid and alkaline produced by sterols in acid alkaline triene conjugated, and through the triene conjugated working on the sodium chloride and only working on the glucose and producing the lactic acid. I have this thing published in my book on around 40 pages because it's all the experiments shown how we arrived to this. But this confirmed from one point of view the problem of the dualism. The dualism in biology is not a dualism by a simple thing, but for it is produced through the activity of the lipids. Lipid dualism by themselves, fatty acids, or sterol with a hydroxyl, alcoholic hydroxyl function. So we have a dualism in biology now, much more precise, due to the fatty acids in one side and due to the sterols, especially in the other side. We developed this concept of dualism. And we started to see that like the acid and the alkaline pain, they are the same thing in other things, not in lesions and not in pain, but in different pathological formations. In tumors. Tumor, everybody knows and believes that it's only anabolic, only growing. At beginning here, but during the treatment we have the ulcerated lesion. We have the pain, an alkaline pain. We have in the tumor an alkaline, a catabolic tumor. Why? The most are the anabolic, constructive growing. It was for tumors. But we started to work and to look on this aspect, anabolic, constructive, catabolic, destructive, as characteristic of other conditions, to find something which was really impressing. A lesion cannot be otherwise, either one or the other. Doesn't exist a lesion to be a lesion like this. It is either anabolic or catabolic, either with the predominance of fatty acids or the predominance of the sterols. This was the most first step in my research in dualism, the existence obligatory for the lesion to be either anabolic or catabolic. Dualism is obligatory condition, and I put it for this thing as a principal condition of a lesion. A lesion is interesting. Until today, everybody studied this, and nobody looked for one character which represents, according to myself, the basic and the most principal, this question of dualism. Is it an anabolic or is it a catabolic lesion? All the lesions are either one or the other. And my first step is obligation in general in the study of any lesion to add something. Not as a secondary, but a very important anabolic or catabolic. with predominant in one or one group of lipids, with predominant in the other or the opposite group of lipids, with predominance in one of acid formation in the other with alkaline. Today, in the biology, in the clinic, and in the pathology, they give a lot of things of character. And missing this question, this primary character of being either anabolic or catabolic. This was very interesting and for me very important, and a definitively step advance in the concept of pathology. The lesion must be either one or the other. Remain the second part, to try to utilize this new concept, to try to treat a lesion, knowing now something what they don't know until now, that they are anabolic or catabolic. And it was the second part of my research. Let's see, do we found for the agents which are utilized therapeutically or in general, this character anabolic or catabolic? And I started an entire study. I found a series of tests. One test was this one. I took an animal and I make a lesion, a rat. And I measure the pH of the wound. I gave him by injection or by mouth an agent. On the second day I measure the pH and I found something very interesting. If I gave him fatty acids, I produce a local change in pH and became more alkaline. You give us all fatty acids, syrup, and produce the opposite. I had a mean by measuring which I called the second day wound cross pH, the character anabolic or catabolic of agents. I was very pleased and I studied, and everything which now I studied to see if it is anabolic or catabolic according to this. But I started, let's see other thing. And I take another reaction, very interesting. I took wounds, I make a wound into the rat or to the mouth, or to the rat. And I measured exactly the surface of the wound. How? I put the cellophane, I draw it exactly, I cut it and weighed it. This weight corresponds to the surface of the wound. And I make this daily measuring. I could not find in the literature something like this, because it's very curious. You will believe that the wound is healing like this, going down. It's not true at all. It goes out, the next day a peak. Going down, a second peak. Sometimes a third peak. It means a second peak. It means that today the wound is a little bigger than it was yesterday in the process of healing. You understand? I repeat this 100 times to see it. And I utilize this. I took the animal, now that the curve is like this, and I gave him the fatty acid. What I saw, very curious, instead of a small peak, I had 3 times, and much bigger. I try and give them sterols. The peak disappeared. The curve went down without peaks. It was a method now to recognize that a substance is an anabolic or a catabolic according to, and confirmed 100% what I found with a pH of the second day. I omitted to say, when I spoke before about the anabolic and catabolic, that in the body there are changes corresponding to a lesion, and which are found in the blood and found in the urine. In the blood, the eosinophils in anabolic are high, in catabolic are down, even to zero. The leukocytes also. The potassium in the serum is a high, it is normally, I consider 4.5 milliequivalent, above catabolic, below anabolic. But in the urine, and in the urine, they wanted to say, if I have a mean to know that the patient is anabolic or catabolic, through the urine. And I studied a little more. I found first the pH of the urine, anabolic, catabolic, isotalkaline, it is simple. But I found something else. I studied the surface tension of the urine. There were some apparatus. And I was interested in the mechanical apparatus myself. A tube graduated specific, and it was made commercially by Clay Adams with the name Revisi Ureotensiometer. It was very interesting. Normally I found around 69, between 69 and 70 centimeters of the surface, you know? And in anabolic, they are above. In catabolic, they are down. This gave us more than indication. Also a kind of measurement, because if I found the catabolic with 56 in surface tension, I knew that it is a strong catabolic. If I found it 68, 67, it mean the same thing. It don't go higher than 73. 73, strong anabolic. 72 anabolic, 71, yes, 60, 70, 69, normal. For the second analysis of the urine, pH, surface tension. I found something else, the elimination of the water. We saw it, that in catabolic running water, the specific gravity indicate the amount of retention or elimination. I cannot enter now in detail because I studied a form which I call it free water in the body, which is in reality giving us the pH, the diuresis. Anyhow, a concentrated urine is catabolic. A very diluted is anabolic. We had so the pH, specific gravity, and surface tension. And we make from this an index. And we studied our patient with a urine daily. When I had Trafalgar Hospital, it was ours. And I had a patient, I had in the morning when I came, every patient had already the index by addition of this street. Until now, it was, for instance, that it was 45. Was he higher, it was anabolic, cadaver with catabolic. So that we had a mean to recognize in a patient with a lesion, with a tumor or anything, if he is anabolic or catabolic, not only by measuring the local, which is not practical. We did that 100 times for research, but practically it's not. But we have it through the blood and through the urine, the three surface tension, specific gravity, and surface tension, urine, pH. This I should tell you before, what I omitted, is a mean in the idea that we have patient anabolic and patient catabolic, a mean how to recognize it. I gave them the mean too, not only the idea that it is, but a mean to recognize it and make the thing infinitely more practically favorable. Now, we come back to that. We found in the substances, anabolic and catabolic, that I told before, we have the second day group and the curve of healing. But we had something more. In the animal, we had the changes which I thought in the human. It means specific gravity, pH and surface tension, the animal who is injected with a substance with anabolic makes the anabolic in his body recognized by the urine too. It is catabolic, he makes it, but in the blood, but in the urine, catabolic. So that we had a mean to recognize from one side the patient, on the other side, the agents, if they are anabolic or catabolic. It was very simple to give to a patient catabolic and anabolic substance. And the first one which I tried was coramine, with amine. It is an anabolic. And he saw something very interesting, before everything, from the beginning, that a catabolic pain goes down, an anabolic pain goes up, because it is increasing the anabolic, but decreasing the catabolic. Now, I went farther, and I found something else. A mean to easily recognize to a patient if a pain is anabolic or a pain is catabolic. By not injecting, I found some substances which I put at the end of the tongue, some drops, and I tell you the formula. It is made by butanol, which is alcohol, it's anabolic. Glycerin, three times hydroxyl, strongly anabolic. Niketamide, the same thing, anabolic. Three substances anabolic. When they put these three substances, a mixture is called BGL, B, butanol, G, glycerin, and niketamide, under the tongue of the patient, who has pain. And 5 minutes later, I tell him his swallow, and start to tell me what happened. And it's unbelievable interesting. The patient with an anabolic pain, the pain increases. With a catabolic pain, the pain goes down, even to disappear, for over 20 minutes, half an hour. This is the meaning which I utilize daily the urine, the blood, and the test to tell us if the patient is anabolic or catabolic, especially through the pain. If he has no pain, we don't make it, but then we have the urine, we measure something more, the temperature. We found high temperature corresponding to catabolic, low temperature, hypothermic, anabolic. And this is one also which are utilized now to determine if the patient is anabolic or catabolic and to see how he responds. Remains only one point, a good element, a good thing to treat anabolic and catabolic. We found fatty acid and this, and I started to study something else, the elements. I knew, and it is known that sometimes somebody taking zinc has some action, and taking copper is an opposite. We knew this thing. I needed something more. So I started and I applied. I can continue? Mm-hmm. And so I applied to the elements the method with the second day, with the urine, with the entire method by elements. And I found sodium strongly anabolic, potassium strongly anabolic, magnesium catabolic, copper catabolic, zinc anabolic, sulfur catabolic, selenium catabolic. I started to see what correlation between elements. And I took the first from the periodic table. Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium. And I made them all. And all anabolic. I went to the second group, to the A2, which is by beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium. And I studied all. And all catabolic. And I jumped. I went to the copper, catabolic. I went to the zinc, anabolic. I went to the sulfur, catabolic. Selenium, catabolic. Tellurium, catabolic. It was a 6A who has oxygen, sulfur, selenium, tellurium. I went to the 7. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. Fluorine, strongly anabolic. Chlorine, strongly anabolic. Bromine, anabolic, iodine, anabolic. And I looked on the periodic table and I thought, we have A and B. The element A means they have except all this is the the sheet of valency, only one not corresponding to the quantum number. These are the A. The B have the sheet and the sheet being beneath, not corresponding to the quantum number. They separate them and they showed that all even, no, all odds, what do I mean, A1, all odds with A are anabolic. All B odds anabolic. The opposite, all odds A are catabolic. All B rate are anabolic. And after I make this picture, that I started one or two or three like this, and confirmed completely. Now we have a periodic table in which we have anabolic, catabolic, anabolic, anabolic, catabolic, anabolic, catabolic, 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 anabolic. Exactly. This was the first step and very important, giving us the series with a character anabolic or catabolic all. During, I didn't speak about the therapeutic, during our research in biology, I make a study of the organization. But in this organization, I told specific entities. For example, the cell is an entity. The nucleus is an entity. The tissue is an entity. An organ is an entity. Subnuclear, chromosome entity, gene entity. And I studied them and I showed that is a succession. I call this the hierarchic organization in which we have the top systemic, the general one. Immediately organ, immediately tissue, immediately cell, immediately nuclei, immediately subnuclear and chromosome. I recognize them, the relationship between them, and I call them level of organization. Because it's something very interesting. In this hierarchic organization, one element, one entity at a level is made, or this I call hierarchy, by the entity immediately beneath as a principal thing bounding a certain thing. It means I showed that every element, no, every entity is made by two parts, a principal and a secondary. The cell nucleus and cytoplasm. Tissue, I found it is the cells and connective material which is negatively charged. The first is cell positively charged. Organ, it is tissue, and I found the lymphocyte part. Systemic, organ plus the circulatory. The leaf, well, no, the nucleus, chromosome with a nucleic map. Nucleic step. Chromosome by genes with chromosomal step and membrane. I showed that every level is made by the entity beneath with a secondary part with a negative charge. This I have had it in mind for all time. When I arrived to the periodic table, I found something very impressive. There are, in periodic table, the series. But there are the periods, the horizontal periods. For instance, the first one is lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, oxygen, fluorine. The first one. These are the periods. And they show that each period corresponds to another level of the organization. The level of the organization, for instance, I told the first one, is lithium, beryllium, so systemic. Others, and they have them like this, horizontal, like level, vertical, anabolic, catabolic. This is, in my book also, this is my systematization of the elements. I found somebody who sent me a publication with a periodic table with a title Revisi Periodic Table. I will not admit it, and I told him, please stop with the stupidity. I have another little interpretation with it. But anyhow, this started an entire field of research in my part. In this research, I showed something very curious. Something which I must recognize is completely new. Nobody has seen this. The lipids, the elements are working in the lipids in the body, bound to lipids, but not bound to lipids. We are made, in general, our body, by two groups, by two systems, the lipidic and the watery. They are not mixing, because the lipids are not soluble in water. And he showed that in every entity and everything, the lipids are the principal. The secondary are in water. I showed that the reaction in the body, they are due principle, they are the lipidic reaction. The body, all the manifestation, all our life are lipidic. We are lipids, principle, and we have the water as a secondary with a certain thing. I took the lipids and I studied and I found something which nobody found before me, that they are bound to be active with an element. And we found practically the elements work through the lipids and the lipids through the elements. Now, the lipids are also, the elements are also in the water. And they found the role. The water appears with the elements to try to ensure the constancy of the lipid in the element. If the element for every organ and for every element represent a certain constant fixed substance, if it is going up or going down, can be abnormal. And this was a big important thing I found, and I found a method. This is a spectral analysis. How and how much we have in the lipids for every element, and for every organ, for everything in the body. And we found that there are constants, but there are also changes, higher and lower. I wanted to know when a change like this represents something abnormal. And I make something very interesting, very original, which I call the profile. I took, for instance, 20, 30 persons and studied practically in the lipids normal what represent the constant of element in the lipids and what represent in water. And this was the thing. Now, I compared for every element the two data, what I found in the lipid and what I found in the water. If both are going up, it is excess. If are going down, deficiency. But not abnormal. And I found the abnormal characterized by opposite changes. And here it is. If pathologically an element goes up, the body tries to correct it and goes down. On the contrary, if it's down, it also corrects it high. And they found, I studied cancer. In cancer, I found lipidic copper low. And it is pathologic because in water, copper 3 times more than usual. Ceruloplasmin. You could measure it, the copper in spectral analysis. And we found in case of cancer, in the lipids of the tumor low, in the lesion, in the water high. You take the tumor out, or you treat it and kill. The patient has no more a problem. In the lipids, normal, and in the water, normal. The patient has a recurrence. The lipids in the copper in the water goes up and up and up, indicating you have to fight something. And this is my method of profile to indicate that in a very different disease we have specific elements which are in some cases exaggerated with abnormal, because in the water it goes down, or in other methods, other elements, too high, too little, because in the water goes high. My profile, instead of this, it is lipids, water. Lipids, water. Profile indicate opposite change. High both, low both, is no pathology. It's excess or doesn't mean anything. Pathologic is high in one, low in the other. higher the one and higher the dose of normal. High in the one or low in the lipid, high in the lipid is pathological. This is my method to correlate through the profile the disease like cancer, like other characterized by lipidic element abnormal, correcting the water. I wanted one idea to tell you. Now, a second very important part. You take, for instance, a patient and you know that he has low copper in a tumor. If I give him the copper in water, it will not go there. I must give him the copper in a lipid. And here was the interesting thing. I had to have a lipid incorporated. And I found a method. I take a lipid who has a double bond. And I introduce an oxygen at the level of a double bond. I oxidize. And after, at a certain temperature, a certain condition, I have a pattern on this, I change the oxygen with the element. And I introduce, like this, the element in the lipid, but where? In the non-polar group. In the polar group, it goes away easy. But in the non-polar group, it is the place of a double bond. And they make the entire field onto a patient. The first thing is to recognize in what site is he. Is an anabolic or a catabolic? How? We make it through the urine, through the pain, and through the blood. Knowing this, if he has a pain, is very helpful because he tells you immediately the pain goes up, the pain goes down. The second is to give the treatment. And how is in the treatment? I thought we have some substances which are glycerol, butanol, and others anabolic, and others which are catabolic, fatty acid, or now I start to introduce the elements, incorporated elements. Now, we show something very interesting. In the body, we don't have free lipids except brain and red cells. All others are bound. Something which I found very capital in my research, that the lesions have free lipids too. Then, knowing that they have free lipids, I can take something to take an incorporated lipid and to rejecting, the lipid goes only to the place where the free lipid, only to the lesions. And bringing there the incorporated substance. Now, we have it's much too broad to
superintendent now. If I can present that all the way, because it is something which is a patent. I want to patent it, and it is not for you, but here it means I cannot patent. I can patent in America for 1 year, but not in Europe. In Europe, if you take it, told that to a big person, you lost the right to. But they didn't know it. I was to Germany with an important patent. And they asked me, did you spoke with somebody? Oh, surely. They told me you cannot patent for. Oh, surely. So let's see if we get you more.
We systematized also the elements, I thought, according to the level, but also some characteristics for certain conditions characterize themselves by the fact that they are attacking the balance in the lipids. Then we are living through the lipids and the water are correcting us. Now, I utilize, this is something very interesting. I found that the sodium chloride represents a dangerous thing in our body, in excess. And I made this experiment. I took rabbits, I gave them cholesterol, I took beef, New Zealand rabbits, and I gave them 2 grams of cholesterol in the food daily. And after 2 weeks, after 4 weeks and 6 weeks, I sacrificed and opened the aorta and found atheromas. I make something else, I design them, and I make a measure so that I can put how much percent we have atheromas in the aorta. I established on 10 or 20 animals that after 2 weeks, one or two, after 4 weeks, so much, after 6 weeks, so much. I took exactly the same thing. The same animal did, and they lived with the same sodium chloride, so they had the same cholesterol, and they gave him sodium chloride to drink. Nothing else. And they measured after 2 weeks, and they found after 2 weeks that the aromas almost like 4 years, or bigger than 4 years. It's 4 weeks, it was like 6 weeks. In 6 weeks it was not one place empty. Sodium chloride increased the arteriosclerosis and the atheromatosis excessively. This is one experiment. Another was very curious, other unknown. This I don't know yet or not, but the second one is not unknown. I took animals, rats, with tumor. And I took 20 rats to which I injected exactly the same amount to have more or less the same tumor. Not a big difference, but I took the same thing. This, at 1 half, I gave him also sodium chloride salt to drink in the keyboard. And I found the tumor growing the double. Instead of tumor like this, I found the tumor like this. And this, who had, is not known. It is my experiment, is a patient who has taken also sodium chloride. The problem was, what can we do
vorgelegt. Und er told, all right, sodium anabolic in my table. Chloride anabolic in my table. More interesting, they are all in the period 3. One it is in the 2, the other it is in the 6, but they are of the 7. But yeah. Then I thought, if it is true, and if my theory is exact, the antagonism, let's take something in the same period, but anabolic, not anabolic, catabolic. And I took magnesium, catabolic, and sulfur, catabolic. And I took sulfur and magnesium in a form of thiosulfate. No, the thiosulfate has a, and I will tell you immediately why I do this, has a sulfur, hexavalent, which is positive, and the bivalent negative is OH, a thio, which is very active. And I took a solution of sodium thiosulfate, and I started to train the experiment. Rabbits with cholesterol and sodium chloride. And to one I gave him the sodium chloride plus the thiosulfate. And all the sodium chloride plus thiosulfate and all the sodium chloride alone. Sodium chloride alone produce exactly the same thing. Sodium chloride with thiosulfate, the lesion in the aorta was more or less than the normal. The tumor not only didn't grow, but went down. The antagonist of our sodium or our sulfur and magnesium against the sodium and chloride was totally reducing complete the noxious effect of sodium chloride. Why I took the thiosulfate? Because I make a corrected salt. And the corrected salt, I have the salt, and I add the thiosulfate, who has no taste and no, I could make magnesium sulfate, but it has a taste and smell. This has no smell and no taste at all. And I put them in a sodium, a corrected salt. Today is sold a quantity of corrected salt by somebody who, in spite of my patent, steal it. But I am now, I have the patent, it's no problem. So I show it to him, but it was questioned in the moment when you want to do it, come to me and give you, I give you the authorization, but to pay something. He did it without it. They pay, but I have the patent of corrected salt, who is salt quantity now. Taste absolutely the same, and I have here corrected salt, surely. I asked them to send me, I believe it is, and I paid $72.
You paid for it.
So, and I paid, but otherwise I could not have it.
So I
have $6 a bottle of sodium over corrected salt. They make a corrected salt also in small for the tables to do that. Now, very interesting. I have already doctor telling me, I doctor, tell Dr. Abisi, I had patients with arteriosclerosis, which I saw in retina. They were for months in use corrected salt when the eyes are infinitely better. I have patients with arteriosclerosis taking the corrected salt, they are doing great. So that we know that we have correcting
this came from the dualism. It is one application of the dualism that anabolic sodium chloride is dangerous, is against cancer and atherosclerosis. Corrected with this, the defect of the sodium chloride annihilated. And if you want, I will give you a little sodium chloride. Corrected salt. There are also many applications, but let's stop it here. And we can start to...
I thank you for that fascinating synopsis of your work, Dr. Ravisi, on dualism. I'd just like to discuss briefly your book, Research in Physiopathology as Basis of Guided Chemotherapy by Emmanuel Ravici. And this is where one could go to get a much more detailed description.
You know that it is a very strong action against me by the danger of my treatment of cancer for the million that the doctor are making. They are utilizing different methods. But they learned something from the Nazis and they applied. They burned my book from 8,000 books, 7,800 were burned. And they know from whom and who.
Well, fortunately, we can still obtain this book here. It's been published by Van Nostrand and Company.
Yes. No, no, it is translated in Europe, but it's reproducing now again. And this time, they will not be able to burn it.
And it's filled with more complete information on your dualism and your concepts and your treatments, and was very, very fascinating. And I think that we have a follow-up question. Mr. Davella would like to ask you, Dr. Ravisi, another question, if you'd be so kind.
Okay. Dr. Ravisi, we know that you are interested in age research. Will you discuss with us your contributions in that field?
Yes. I was very interested in viruses. And I was in Paris when the war, before I came to Europe, to America. And I had an accident. We broke a vial. It infected us. It was not AIDS, it was not 5 years ago. And I had a little paralysis of the arm and a little paralysis of the eye. But one moment I could not breathe. And they brought me, they put me in the iron lung. And they lived in the iron lung sometimes. I paid my research in viruses. Now, a question of AIDS. In the question of AIDS, the problem is they are all time discussing and trying how to kill the virus. But it's not a problem. The virus is free only for moments. The other time is protected by the lymphocytes. The virus is in the lymphocytes, where it is growing and growing and growing. In the moment when they arrive mature, break the lymphocytes, become free, and attack other lymphocytes. So the time
of freedom when can be attacked is relatively reduced. What is a disease? With lymphocytes, with viruses protected, is something else who is sick. A lymphocyte. The lymphocyte is parasitated. It is a lymphocyte, sick lymphocyte. And the same sick lymphocyte, it has also the lipids of the lymphocyte, which are like an other lesion. When I described and discussed the lymphocyte, I told the head has a lesion. The lesion of the head is a parasitated sick lymphocyte. If you want to treat the AIDS, you must attack the viruses, but that is only for minutes, so that they are protected, but attack something else, the lesion, the sick lymphocyte. And consider the lesion like other lesions, and you attack it. When we spoke about the hierarchic, I spoke that the hierarchic organization has one level, level number three, in which we have the organ. But the organ has a secondary for the lymphocytes. That if we want to attack the lymphocytes, we must go to attack them at this level where they are, at the level of organ. And in order to attack the level of organ, you must find substances which are in this period. And in this period you must look for something catabolic destructive. If you take anything, it will not work, or very little, to work on the lymph. And this was, I looked for, it is a sulfur, the bivalent sulfur. I was at this moment in Europe at the University of Bologna. And I gave them a substance in which I had, I make it there, which I had the sulfur incorporated in a lipid, the bivalent negative sulfur. And the experiment was amazing. It took tubes with lymphocytes parasitated full with AIDS. And in this tube, they took a certain substance, L24, secreted by them, indicate presence and strong activity. And they found it enormous. They took another tube like this, and they introduced our substance, incorporated sulfur. And the result, this one like this, the other was here. And repeat again zero. Not one. I tried several to show the sulfur. I tried the sulfur bound to salicylic acid. And was also the same thing, killing the microbe, the lymphocyte, which was secreted this substance, and killing also the virus. And this is the basis of our treatment. In the treatment of AIDS, I don't attack immediately, but it's important, the virus, I attack the lymphocyte. With what? With bivalent selenium incorporated. And this is our treatment, very successful in the in the treatment with selenium, with sulfur.
There are two things important: bivalent negative sulfur and amount of sulfur. We are treating with substances which are very rich in sulfur, in bivalent. But we reach it with a salt who has 69.5% sulfur bivalent in a molecule. But more than this, how I choose this substance? They cannot choose from millions, but they choose it from the formula in which it is trithiophenylformaldehyde, in which I have the sulfur bound, each one is two carbons. It is a six. It is sulfur, carbon, sulfur, carbon, sulfur, carbon, sulfur, carbon. It is, so that you have the sulfur not bound with something else than two carbons, so when it is liberated, liberated as such. And for this I choose it. Preferred high amount, and second, because in the formula, not to have the sulfur bond to something else, except with very loving. The substance is breaks, but it breaks, liberates the sulfur as such. And this was what I needed. And in reality, it's working. It's working by injection. Possible to try by mouth, but what today by injection. And to obtain results, usually in a few days, you see the patient changing. And cancer, you utilize the same substance. But with a thing very curious, we obtain in cancer in a short treatment, less than a month, a total necrosis of the cancer. But the tumor is there. It was interesting. It was a sister of a director of Memorial Hospital. And they want a mastectomy. Get a tumor here and a tumor in the other. And the tumor is big enough. I put it in this treatment. After a month, the tumor was there. I knew, but I told them, the tumor will go, because in animals, I have dead tumor, no transplant positive, but the tumor needs time this to be resolved. They took it out. Then they gave it to a pathologist, this totally dead tumor in Memorial Hospital. They gave it to another, three, four laboratories, and all recognized not one single cell. I told them, left the other thing this. They are years now without recurrence. The tumor here, and she knew she had the tumor, because every time when she had injection, she had a sensation here and here. 10 minutes after, for 20 minutes, the action of the tumor. In animals, the same thing, we obtain destruction, necrosis. And this is a point now, I make some change now with beryllium to try to reduce us. But otherwise, it is a principle, let's try cancer by killing the cells as such. Not what happened after, in the moment you're killed, the danger disappears. But this possible months to resolve. Instead of this, now I have to be other research trying to resolve the death. But otherwise, it's interesting. I have a patient, and I have animals. An animal is very interesting. I have a tumor like this, and they take it and transplant it. If it would be one single cell alive, it would be produced. Not one positive. That I know that this substance is killing totally the cells. And this is a substance which I utilize also
in AIDS to work against whom? Against the lymphocyte, who is in the level in 3 periods, and with the sulfur, which is the strongest catabolic in this area. The results which you obtain are, I don't want to much for the moment, encouraging, not to utilize other qualifications.
Thank you, Dr. Ravisi, for that very, very interesting and fascinating discussion. I would like to thank you for being with us, and on behalf of Mr. Adrian Himmelbrand and Mr. Sal Zabella, and myself, I'm Joanne Lejeune. We'd like to thank Dr. Ravisi for sharing with us his fascinating and encouraging research for the future. And we have had the pleasure of meeting today with one of the great minds of the century. And it's been an honor, Dr. Ravisi.
I thank you for 2 things. For your interest in my research, for your kindness who came to organize this, and also for the pleasure which I'm speaking.
it's been everyone's pleasure. Thank you very much.